Everybody said, let me hear your amen. Father, we thank you for this time. We bless your name for your goodness. Thank you for bringing us together. And thank you for the challenges you are giving us. Thank you for preparing us, not only for personal life and holiness, but for ministry. We're asking, Lord, that tonight you enrich every life once again with your word in Jesus' name. We're asking, Lord, that your word will profit everyone. And through us, your word will profit the people we're going to be ministering to in Jesus' name. Be glorified in every life. Establish your word and the ministry in every minister. Thank you because we know you have answered. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Give me a good amen. Amen. We're looking at Matthew chapter 28. And I'm reading from verses 18, 19, and 20. Matthew chapter 28, verse 18. Jesus came and spake unto them, saying, all power is given unto me in heaven and in earth. Go ye therefore, and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost, teaching them to observe all things whatsoever I have commanded you. And lo, I am with you always, even unto the end of the world. And the church said, I said the church said, looks like the cold is taking your voice. Let the church say. Tonight we're looking at the Great Commission. Unwavering commitment to Christ's Great Commission. Christ is the founder of the church. Christ is the foundation of the church. He is the door into the church. And he is the key also to salvation. He is the head as well as the cornerstone of the church. He is the savior, the sanctifier of the church, the captain and the leader of the church. He is the truth, truth personified, and the teacher of the church. He is the judge and the final authority in the church. The judge and the final authority. We're preaching the gospel. We're reaching the world. We're touching lives. We're telling people, come to the Lord. But how we do it and how the people respond will determine their eternal destiny. When you think about it, that your faithfulness to the Great Commission, your faithfulness in imparting the gospel, preaching the gospel to other people, that will determine their eternal destiny. Either they go to heaven or they go to hell. What you teach, what you say, how you do it, how you say it, will determine whether the Lord, as the key into the kingdom, will open the door for them and they'll get into the kingdom or not. His commission is clear. His mandate is binding. His way is perfect. And his word is permanent. His teaching is eternal, unchanging, and is the standard by which he'll measure whether people get to heaven or not. And now he tells us, look at verse 19 again. Go ye therefore and teach all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Ghost. And he says, as we bring them in, they're not just to remain babes and converts. They become learners. They become disciples. And we're teaching them to observe all things. Whether you are faithful to that or not will determine what the people know and what the people learn. Whether we teach part of the Bible or the whole of the Bible will determine what the people will hear, what the people will learn. What the Lord has commanded is that we teach all things whatsoever he has commanded. Obviously, then that means it's going to be evaluated on the final day. When people come in, they come in, they want to get to heaven. And the Lord is going to ask them or know from them whether they have heard, whether they have followed all that they should have heard, all they should have followed. We're looking at Mark chapter 16. And I'm reading from verses 15 and 16. Mark chapter 15, 16, verse 15. And he said unto them, go ye into all the world and preach the gospel to every creature. Preach the gospel. What people define as the gospel may not be exactly what Christ himself defined as the gospel. As we go through the scriptures, you'll see the kind of scripture or the kind of a gospel that Jesus preached. And he wants us to take that same gospel, the one he preached, that same gospel that the apostles preached, that same gospel that the ministers of the New Testament preached, and go give it to the world so that they believe the right thing. It says in verse 16, he that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. But he that believeth not, what will happen? He that believeth not, I said, what will happen? Shall be damned. There are people that, you know, have the erroneous idea that everybody will eventually get to heaven. Everybody will eventually be saved. Everybody will eventually get to that place where Christ has gone to prepare. But Jesus said, no. Those who believe, they believe the whole gospel. And they live by that whole gospel. It says they will be saved. And those who believe not will be damned. We're looking at Luke chapter 24. Luke chapter 24, we're reading from verse 27. In Luke chapter 24, verse 27, I'm beginning at Moses and at all the prophets, he expounded unto them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself. He's telling us that as we look at the books of Moses from Genesis to Deuteronomy, he talks about Christ. As we talk about the whole of the rest of the Old Testament, it talks about Christ. And Christ opened the understanding of his own disciples. And it says, beginning at Moses, at the books of Moses, and at all the prophets, he expounded unto them all the things concerning himself. Verse 44. He said in verse 44, he said unto them, these are the words which I spake unto you while I was yet with you, that all things must be fulfilled which were written in the law of Moses and in the Psalms concerning me. Then opened he their understanding. I pray the Lord will open our understanding tonight. He'll open your understanding. He opened their understanding that they might understand the scriptures. And said unto them, thus it is written, and thus it behooved Christ to suffer and to rise from the dead the third day. Listen to this. And that repentance and remission of sins should be preached in his name. Tell me the rest. Tell me out aloud. Among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. He wants us to preach repentance. And he says, beginning at Jerusalem, we'll preach repentance first. And then if there's repentance and faith in Christ, remission of sin, forgiveness of sins, there'll be redemption. Tonight, we're looking at the message on unwavering commitment to Christ's great commission. That great commission belongs to Christ. And has given us the parameters of that great commission. He has given us the message of that great commission. He has told us the things to preach and the things to emphasize in that great commission. And if we're going to be rewarded on the final day, if the blood of the people are not going to be required from us, we need to preach what he wanted, what he has said and stipulated we must preach. We have unwavering commitment, unwavering consecration, unwavering devotion to the great commission of the Lord Jesus Christ. Three things we're looking at. Number one, the passionate preaching of repentance. The passionate preaching of repentance. The word of God is very clear. As you look at the word, you'll find that our Lord Jesus Christ himself preached repentance. And not only that he preached repentance, he commanded all his ministers to preach repentance. What's repentance? Repentance is total renunciation of sin with genuine hatred for the old ways of the sinner. The sinner hears the word of God. It comes under conviction when we preach in the power, in the witness, in the unction, in the anointing of the Spirit of God. Because Jesus promised us, he said, he'll go. It's expedient for you that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come. But if I go away, I will send him unto you. And when he comes, he will reprove the world of sin, convict the world of sin. When we preach in the power of the Holy Spirit, in the unction of the Holy Spirit, when we preach with the anointing of the Holy Spirit, there'll be conviction in the hearts of the sinners, and they'll be convicted that sin is evil, sin is rebellion, sin is fighting against God, sin makes us enemies of God. They will hate the sin, they'll be sorry they were living in sin, and they'll turn away, they renounce their sin. Repentance is the total renunciation of sin with genuine hatred for the old ways of the sinner. That means then, as we look at the Bible, you'll find, this may surprise you, there's no place in the New Testament where the preacher just said, raise up your hand, accept Christ, and that's over. No. What he did was, he preached repentance to the people according to the words of the Lord. And when they turned from their sin, when they repented of their sin, they believed on the Lord Jesus Christ, and they were saved. And then Christ accepted them. It's not we accepting Christ, it's Christ accepting us when we are born again, when we turn away from sin. And so to tell a sinner, just accept Christ, that's all you do. We know that that's what everybody says, that's what all the preachers are saying, but Jesus never said, go and tell them to accept me, go and tell them to repent, go and tell them to turn away from sin. It is the turning away from sin, it is the repentance with the hatred of sin, with renunciation of sin, that makes the sinner to actually get reconciled unto God. And let's look at the ministry of Christ. Let's see the way he did it and the way we ought to do it. We're looking at Matthew chapter 4. Matthew chapter 4, I'm reading from verse 17. From that time, Jesus began to preach and to say, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. That's how Jesus started the ministry. And he said, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. In fact, in all the places where he preached and what miracles, the people that did not repent caused sorrow and grief of heart to him. And whenever we declare the word of God, we're not motivating them, we're not entertaining them, we're not just keeping their interest, we're not trying to bring them into a church, into a local assembly. We want them to get to heaven. Coming to a local assembly, that's one thing. Coming to a denomination, that's one thing. But turning away from sin, repenting of their sins, and being totally forgiven and cleansed, that's the real thing. Look at Matthew chapter 11. In Matthew chapter 11, I'm reading from verse 20. Matthew chapter 11, verse 20. Then began he to upbraid to rebuke the cities wherein most of his mighty works were done, because they repented not. That's what he was looking for. They brought their sick to be healed. Jesus said, that's not enough. They said, what a great miracle. A great prophet had arisen before us. That Jesus said, that's not the end. He wanted them to repent. He preached to them that they will repent. And whenever they did not repent, that caused sorrow of heart to him. And that brought rebuke, chastisement from him. Then began he to rebuke, reprove, and upbraid the cities wherein most of his mighty works were done, because they repented not. Verse 21, woe unto you, Chorazin. Woe unto you, Bethsaida. For if the mighty works that were done in you had been done in Tyre and Sidon, they would have, what's the word? Repented long time in sackcloth and ashes. That's the expectation, that they should repent. And so, never go out and tell sinners who have not repented, accept Christ, as if a Christ is, you know, is waiting for the sinner to appreciate him, for the sinner to love him, and Christ will be so glad if he's so fortunate that you, terrible sinner, shameful sinner, will accept him. No. We preach the word that they should repent. And it is that repentance that Christ is looking for. Look at verse 22. But I say unto you, it shall be more tolerable for Tyre and Sidon at the day of judgment than for you. Look at verse 23. And thou Capernaum, thou art which art exalted unto heaven, shall be brought down to hell. For if the mighty works that were done in thee had been done in Sodom, it will have remained until this day. But I say unto you, that it shall be more tolerable for the land of Sodom in the land in the day of judgment than for thee. Chapter 12 of Matthew. Matthew chapter 12. We're reading from verse 39. Matthew chapter 12, verse 39. But he answered and said unto them, an evil and adulterous generation seeketh after a sign. There shall no sign be given to it, but the sign of the prophet Jonas. Look at verse 40. For as Jonah was 3 days and 3 nights in the whale's belly, so shall the Son of Man be 3 days and 3 nights in the heart of the earth. Listen to verse 41. The men of Nineveh shall rise in judgment with this generation and shall condemn it, because they, what's the word there? They repented at the preaching of Jonas, and behold, a greater than Jonas is here. Very clear in the word of God that Christ expects that the sinner will repent, turn to the Lord. Only then will they have redemption, salvation. Only then will they be reconciled to God and have a place in heaven. Mark chapter 1. I'm reading from verse 14. Mark chapter 1, verse 14. It says in verse 14, now, after that John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee, preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God. And in the message of Christ, what are the elements of the gospel of Christ? In the presentation of Christ, what are the elements of that gospel? Look at verse 15. And saying, the time is fulfilled, the kingdom of God is at hand. Tell me what follows. Repent ye and do what? And believe the gospel. It's not just believe, believe, believe. What are they believing? They must turn away from their sin. They must understand that the solution is coming because of a problem. It's a problem of sin. And they must turn away from their sin if they are going to have the mercy of God, the salvation of God. We're looking at Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2, and I'm reading here from verse 17. Mark chapter 2, verse 17. When Jesus had it, he said unto them, they that are whole have no need of physician, but they that are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to what? To repentance. That's what he came to do. And that's what we must emphasize. Because if the people do not know that they are sinners, how do they know that they need a savior? It is because they are sinners, that's why they need a savior. And we're telling them that they need to turn away from sin so that the mercy of God, the forgiveness of God will come to them. We're looking at Luke chapter 13. Luke chapter 13, I'm reading from verse 3. I tell you nay, but except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. The people that respond to our preaching, if they don't repent, if they just love what we present to them, and they want to come and get a particular blessing because we're telling them this is going to happen, that is going to happen, but we're not emphasizing salvation. We're not emphasizing repentance. We're not emphasizing leaving their sin and quitting their sin and leaving all that darkness and coming to the light. If they come and they may even fill the auditorium, if there is no repentance, they will all likewise perish. Look at verse 5. In verse 5 it says, I tell you nay, but except ye repent, ye shall all likewise perish. You don't want the people you are preaching to perish. The people you are bringing in to perish. If you don't want them to perish, you'll preach repentance unto them. Luke chapter 24, I'm reading from verse 47. Luke chapter 24, verse 47. And that repentance and remission of sins should be preached, must be preached, ought to be preached. If we want to do any good at all to the sinners, if we want to do any good at all in the kingdom of God, if we want to do any good at all in the ministry, repentance and remission of sins must be preached, should be preached, ought to be preached in his name among all nations, beginning at Jerusalem. As you come to Acts of the Apostles, you'll find the same thing. They emphasize that repentance. Not just accept Christ as your personal Savior, accept him. Once you just raise up your hand, that's all over. No, it's not all over. They must turn away from sin. And they must know what they are turning away from. It must be very clear in their mind, I have been a sinner. And then my sin is causing sorrow and grief in the heart of God, in the heart of Christ. And if I continue in this life of sinning, I'm going to perish. And I don't want to perish because of that, Lord, I am sorry. Because of that, Lord, I turn away from my sin and I turn to the Lord Jesus Christ so that he will forgive me, he will accept me. He is the one accepting the sinner after repentance. It's not the sinner doing Christ a favor and accepting him. And so we need to change our orientation and make sure that we keep to the word of God, we keep to the Bible, they turn away from sin, they repent of their sin, they renounce their sin, they hate their sin, they're sorrowful for their sin, and they believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. They are forgiven, they are saved, and Christ accepts them. Look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 2, and I'm reading from verse 37. Acts chapter 2, we're reading from verse 37. It tells us here in verse 37, now when they had this, they were pricked in their hearts. They were convicted in their hearts. They felt guilty because of what they had done, and said unto Peter and to the rest of the apostles, men and brethren, what shall we do? And in verse 38, then Peter said unto them, tell me out aloud, Repent. That's the word. That's the word. That's the very first thing we're telling the sinners. We're telling the sinners, repent. It may be on the street, repent. It may be in the open, repent. It may be in a church building, repent. And then it says, and we baptize every one of you in the name of Jesus for the remission of sin. Repent for the remission of sin. Ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Chapter 3. In chapter 3, verse 19, it says, repent ye therefore. You sinned, repent ye therefore. You are in darkness, repent ye therefore. You are far away from God, repent ye therefore. You want to get into the kingdom of God, repent ye therefore. You want to benefit from what Christ has done on the cross of Calvary, repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out. The sins will not be blotted out if they don't repent. If they are clinging to their sin, if they're embracing their sins, if they love their sins, if no preacher tells them they have to repent, if no preacher tells them they have to turn away from that evil and say total bye-bye, final bye-bye to the sin, if they don't do that, their sins will not be blotted out. Repent ye therefore and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. Look at verse 26. Unto you first God, having raised up his son Jesus, sent him to bless you in turning away, how many people? Every one of you from his iniquity. That's the purpose. That's the goal. That's why we're preaching. That's why we're going to those sinners. We don't just want to fill the church with people, with those who are sinners, and then we're advertising the church. We're putting a great image, a good image on the church. I want to be there. You ought to be there. You know, it will be wonderful if you can. Well, you'll do us a favor if you can be there. No, the sinner is not doing anybody a favor. He is going to perish if he doesn't repent. He's going to perish if he doesn't have Christ that cleanses him, that changes his life, that transforms his life. And so we need to have the proper orientation, because it is not, they're not coming to worship the Bagada church building, they're coming to worship the Lord. If they're going to worship the Lord and their worship is going to be acceptable in the sight of God, they must turn, every one of them, from their iniquity. Look at chapter 17 of Acts. Acts chapter 17, I'm reading from verse 30. Acts chapter 17, we're looking at verse 30. And look at what the word of God emphasizes. It tells us in verse 30, it says, at the times of this ignorance, God winged out. But now, commanders, how many people? Commanders all men, where? Everywhere, to do what? To repent. You see, in the sight of God, May 2018 makes no difference. Bagada church building or IBTC, to God it makes no difference. You are in the local assembly there in your district, or you are here at headquarters church, it makes no difference. It's not looking at the physical structure. It's looking at his word, and it's looking at the commandment he has given to the ministers and what the ministers are to emphasize. And it is that they will turn away from their sins. It says, the times of this ignorance, God winged that. And now at this time, if you're inviting them, if you're bringing them, it's not bringing them to a church building, you're bringing them to Christ. He commandeth all men everywhere to repent. I pray God will give us the right message and the right attitude, and will proclaim it without changing the message, in Jesus' name. I saw the church will say amen. Amen. We're looking at Acts of the Apostles, chapter 26, verse 19. Acts chapter 26, I'm reading from verse 19. It says in verse 19, whereupon, O King Agrippa, I was not disobedient to the heavenly vision, but first I am showed unto them of Damascus and at Jerusalem and throughout all the coast of Judea, and then to the Gentiles that they should, tell me again, they should repent and turn to God and do works meet for repentance. That's the message. That's the message. Anytime, every time. Look at 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3. 2 Peter chapter 3, reading from verse 9. The Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to us, what? Is waiting for us, he being patient for sinners, not willing that any should perish, but that, how many people? Should do what? Should come to repentance. That all should come to repentance. As you see the word of God from the beginning of the New Testament to the end of the New Testament, repentance is the first requirement. If the sinner is to find favor, the sinner is to find mercy, if the sinner is to find salvation in Christ, it was the unmistakable demand of God. In the Old Testament, Ezekiel chapter 18, Ezekiel chapter 33, it was the unmistakable demand of God. In 2 Chronicles chapter 7, verse 14, the unmistakable demand of God that men should repent. If they're going to have forgiveness, if they're going to get to heaven, if they're going to have his favor, his mercy, his salvation, and his redemption, repentance. If it was the unmistakable demand of God, don't you remember? It was a central message of John the Baptist. The central message of John the Baptist. Anyone that came, any kind, any group of people that came, he emphasized to them, repent, for the kingdom of God is at hand. It was a constant emphasis of Christ. The constant emphasis of Christ, repent, repent, repent. There is joy in heaven over one sinner that repented than for 99 other people that don't need repentance. It was his final authoritative mandate as the master. He told all the disciples, he says, here is what to do. You go into the world and you emphasize repentance. And when the day of Pentecost came, the first message that was preached, that message, the opening message of the apostles at Pentecost, what was that? Repent. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, is the passionate call and the preaching till the end of the New Testament. Till the end of the New Testament, repent. Every time, repent. And now Jesus talking from heaven in Revelation chapter 2. Revelation chapter 2, and I'm reading here from verse 15. He's talking from heaven, and now he's still going to emphasize the same thing, which means he does not change. He's still the same today. If he came into our world today to preach the gospel directly by himself, he'll still be emphasizing the same thing. Repent. Revelation chapter 2, and I'm reading from verse 15. So as thou also, them that hold the doctrine of the Nicolaitans, which thing I hate. That's Christ talking, the things he hates. He hates the sins of the people. He hates the iniquity of the people. He hates the defilement of the people. He hates the hypocrisy and the falsehood of the people. And he's not willing that hypocrites should just accept him, and that the defiled person, prostitute, should just accept him. The thief, the robber, should just accept him. And that is, no, he hates all those actions of theirs, and he wants repentance from them. Look at verse 16, repent. Or else I will come unto thee quickly and will fight against them with the sword of my mouth. Look at verse 20. Verse 20, notwithstanding, I have a few things against thee, because thou sufferest that woman Jezebel, which calleth herself a prophetess, to teach and to seduce my servants, and to commit fornication, and to eat things sacrificed unto idols. You know, there are people that will say, this is New Testament. is the age of grace. Let us come therefore boldly to the throne of grace, that we might find help in the time of need. That God doesn't look at people's sins anymore. All he's looking at now is Jesus Christ. All he's looking at now is Calvary. All he's looking at now is the sacrifice that he paid, the price at Calvary. And so whatever you do, and whoever you are, just come, because Christ has paid it all. That same Christ is saying that he hates the fornication reflected here, and he hates the eating of sacrifice to idols here. In verse 21, and I gave her space to repent of her fornication, and she repented not. Behold, I will cast her into a bed of affliction, and them that commit adultery with her into great tribulation, except they, tell me, repent of their deeds. He's still talking from heaven. He's talking from glory. And he's saying, if I were there directly, minister, I'll tell them, repent. And that's what you tell them, repent. Look at chapter 3, verse 19. As many as I love, I rebuke and chasten. Be zealous, therefore, and do watch. Repent. After that repentance, look at verse 20. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man, after repentance, hear my voice and open the door, after repentance, I will come in and will sup with him, and he with me. To him that overcometh will I grant to sit with me in my throne, even as I also overcame and am set down with my Father in his throne. He that has an ear, let him hear what the Spirit says unto the churches. The Spirit is speaking to his church. I have ears to hear. I will hear. I will make my message according to the word of the Lord. Go tell the sinners, repent. No repentance, no reconciliation. No repentance, no redemption. No repentance, no regeneration. No repentance, no restoration. No repentance, no remission of sin. No repentance, no recognition in heaven. No repentance, no rest in glory. If we're going to have reconciliation with God, there must be repentance. If we're going to have redemption, redemption that Jesus Christ has paid for, the gauge to that redemption is repentance. If there's going to be regeneration, the new birth, being born again, the gauge and the way, the path, the road to that regeneration is repentance. If we're going to have restoration, a backslider is gone away from the Lord. It's a prodigal son in the far country. And now he wants to come back home. He wants the father to receive him. The father will not go to him in the far country. And he's not, he's not saying, Father, I'm in the far country, but I accept you. I accept you. No, that's not enough. Prodigal son, prodigal daughter, a sinner. If there is going to be restoration, there must be repentance. There's going to be remission of sin, that he'll remove your sin, he'll remove the sinner's sin, and he will cleanse them and wash them. There must be repentance. If there's going to be recognition when you get over there, because many people will come and they will say, have we not done many wonderful works in your name? Have we not done this and professing in your name? And Jesus will tell them, I never knew you, depart from me, ye that work iniquity. If you're going to be recognized on the other side, there must be repentance, and then there abides, there remains rest for the people of God. But you remember, even though the work was finished, it was promised to some people, and they did not receive, did not enter into that rest. That's why it's saying, let us watch, let us be careful, lest that promise remaining for us, none of us, any of us, shall come short of it, because the word is not mixing with faith in our heart. If there's going to be rest in glory, there must be repentance. Repentance is the key. preach it, and the Lord will honor your ministry in Jesus' name. Point number two. It's point number two, the practical proof in restitution. The practical proof, the proof of repentance. Somebody says he has repented. Well, that's his testimony, that's his confession, that's his utterance, that's what he's saying. How do we know? How do we prove that this is real repentance, genuine repentance? Point number two, the practical proof in restitution. We're looking at Luke chapter 19. In Luke chapter 19, I'm reading from verse 5. Luke chapter 19, we're looking at verse 5. In verse 5, it says, and when Jesus came to the place, he looked up, and he saw him, and said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must abide at thy house. And he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. As many as received him, to them he gave a power to become the sons of God, even to those that believed on his name. And when they saw it, they all murmured, saying that he was gone to be guest to a man that is a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And read it with me. 1, 2, 3, go. That's a good trial. 1, 2, 3, go once again. Praise the Lord. And if I have taken anything, if I have taken anything, taking it by violence, taking it by fraud, taking it by deception, taking it by usurpation, taking it by policy, taking it by habit, if I have taken anything, if I've taken anything like money, if I've taken anything like the property of other people, if I've taken anything like the land of other people, if I've taken anything from any man, any poor man, any innocent man, any oppressed man, any person that could not defend himself, and I oppressed him, and I took something away from him by false accusation, by kind of position and authority, I can do this, and you can go to court, I'll meet you there. It says, if I've done that, I restore him fourfold. There are people that are quick to tell us. You read that in books, and you hear that from preachers. Oh, they said, restitution. That's deeper life doctrine. Restitution is the law. And you are legalistic if you demand restitution. That's, you are legalistic if you preach restitution. It came at the time of Moses, that's what they say, and it went with the law of Moses. It's abolished, it's annulled, it's destroyed, it's taken out of the way. As Moses and the law are taken out of the way, restitution is taken out of the way. Read your Bible very well. Restitution was there before the time of Moses. Genesis. Restitution remained after the law of Moses, the time of Christ, the time of the apostles. Let's look at it before Moses. We're coming to Genesis chapter 20. And I'm reading from verse 1. Genesis chapter 20, verse 1. And Abraham journeyed from thence toward the south country, and dwelt between Kadesh and Shur, and sojourned in Gerar. And Abraham said of Sarah, his wife, she is my sister. And Abimelech, king of Gerar, innocently sent and took Sarah. But God came to Abimelech in a dream by night and said to him, behold, thou art but a dead man, for the woman which thou hast taken, for she is a man's wife. It's not Moses, this is God Almighty himself. This man did not belong to any local assembly. This man did not belong to any church denomination. This man did not belong to any kind of a traditional religion. He was just a king, and then he heard that, you know, Sarah was available and free, not knowing that she was wife to Abraham, and took her. And then God said, you are a dead man. You are a dead man. If you die physically in this condition, you are totally, finally, and forever separated from God. You are a dead man. Look at verse 4. But Abimelech had not come near her, and he said, Lord, will thou slay also a righteous nation? Said he not unto me, she is my sister, and she, even she herself, said, he is my brother. In the integrity of my heart and innocency of my hands have I done this. I'm innocent of this. If you need to blame anybody, blame Sarah or blame Abraham, because they were the people that deceived me into this. It says in verse 6, and God said unto him in a dream, yea, I know that thou didst this in the integrity of thine heart, for I also withheld thee from sinning against me. Therefore suffered I thee not to touch her. Now, therefore, what follows? Restore the man his wife. What's that? Tell me out aloud. I say, what's that? Is this legalistic? No. This is not Moses. This is the Almighty God himself. And God says, I am God, I change not. He's still God. And he's still demanding today what he demanded before the law. Because he said, restore the man his wife, for he is a prophet, and he shall pray for thee, and thou shalt live. And if thou restore her not, God is merciful, I don't have to do restitution. If thou restore her not, the grace of God is abundant, and I don't have to do restitution. If thou restore her not, when a new dispensation, this is a new day, this is a new dawn, forget about restitution, come before the Lord and just rejoice. But if you restore her not, Bagada building doesn't change the doctrine of the Bible. The new day, the new dawn, the new dispensation does not change the doctrines of the Bible. The standard of God remains the same. The salvation we have, the salvation we claim, should be the salvation of the Bible. That a person has repented, and the proof of that repentance is that he hates sin, he denounces sin, and he renounces sin. And he says, because that is sinful, I remove my hand. Any object of sin that had been there, now that I'm born again, now that I repent, I must do away with that. Now therefore restore the man his wife, for he is a prophet, and he shall pray for thee, and thou shalt live. If thou restore her not, know that thou shalt do what? Surely die thou and all that are thine. Therefore, verse 8, Abimelech arose early in the morning and called all the servants and told all these things in their ears, and the men were so afraid. Then Abimelech called Abraham and said unto him, what hast thou done unto us, and what have I offended thee that thou hast brought on me and on my kingdom a great sin? And thou hast done deeds unto me that ought not to be done. And Abimelech said unto Abraham, what sawest thou, that thou hast done this thing? And you know it goes on, but as you look at verse 14, and Abimelech took sheep and oxen and men servants and women servants and gave them unto Abraham. If Abimelech stopped there, has he done the will of God? Has he obeyed God? okay, I've taken Sarah from you, and God is saying, restore the woman, but I love her. And how can I live without Sarah? Because since she came to my house, I just love the sight of her. And God is saying, restore the woman to her husband. Okay, I'll do this. I'll give you men servants, plural. I'll give you women servants, plural. I'll give you sheep, plural. I'll give you oxen, plural. The only thing I don't want to part with is Sarah. The man will still die under the judgment of God. But look at the latter part of verse 14. And he restored him, Sarah, his wife, before the law of Moses. We're coming to Genesis chapter 42. Genesis chapter 42, I'm reading from verse 27 and verse 28, before the law. Genesis 42, verse 27. It says in verse 27, and one of them opened a sack to give his ass provender in the inn, and he espied his money, for behold, it was in his sack's mouth. And he said unto his brethren, my money is restored, and lo, it is even in my sack. And their heart failed them, and they were afraid, saying one to another, what is this that God has done unto us? These were the brothers of Joseph. They went to Egypt to buy food. And then as they paid the money, and then they had been instructed that they should return their money to their sacks without informing them. And as they were going on the way and they opened their bags, they saw the money. They said, what is this? Look at the money. The money that doesn't belong to us anymore, we paid this money to the people. This is Genesis, remember? It's before the Lord. Look at verse 35. In verse 35, and it came to pass, as they emptied their sacks, that behold, every man's bundle of money was in his sack. And when both they and their father saw the bundles of money, they were afraid. They didn't say, well, whatever happened, this is God, this is miracle. See, all the food we brought from Egypt, and we don't have to pay anything, and the money is, you know, those people were careless, and they left the money. They didn't say that. They were afraid. This is Genesis. Look at what they did now. We're looking at chapter 43, verse 2. In chapter 43, we're looking at verse 2. And it came to pass, when they had eaten up the corn which they had brought out of Egypt, their father said unto them, go again and buy us a little food. Look at verse 12. In verse 12, and take double money in your hand. And the money that was brought again in the mouth of your sacks, carry it again in your hand. Peradventure it was an oversight. You see that? That's restitution. The money doesn't belong to us anymore. And this is Genesis. This is the period and dispensation of conscience. They had conscience. You see people today, it's like they don't have any conscience. They've stolen money from the government. They've stolen money from their company. They've stolen money from their employers. They've stolen money from wherever. And then they say they are born again. They're children of God. If you're children of God, if we have repented, the proof of that repentance is restitution. Look at what he did now in verse 15. And the men took the present, and they took double money in their hand, and Benjamin, and arose and went down to Egypt and stood before Joseph. Look at verse 19. In verse 19, and they came near to the stewards of Joseph's house, and they communed with him at the door of the house, and they said, oh, sir, we came indeed down at the first time to buy food. And it came to pass, when we came to the inn, that we opened our sacks, and behold, every man's money was in the mouth of his sack. Our money in full weight, and we have brought it again in our hands. The money that wasn't taken, we don't know what happened. A mistake happened somehow, and now that money was returned to us. We don't know who did that. We brought that money back in our hands. Verse 22, and other money have we brought down in our hands to buy food. We cannot tell who put our money in our bags. What's that? Restitution. They wouldn't keep the money. And people today tell us, I'm born again, I've repented. There's no proof of their repentance. If we are truly repentant, then we'll see your conscience will be a new conscience. Your conscience will be a renewed conscience, and your conscience will make what was wrong to become right. We're coming to Romans chapter 2. Romans chapter 2. I'm reading here from verse 14. Romans chapter 2, verse 14. For when the Gentiles, which have not the law, do by nature the things contained in the law, these, having not the law, are a law unto themselves, which show the work of the law, reaching in their hearts, their conscience, also bearing witness, and their thoughts, meanwhile, accusing or else excusing one another. Repentance is produced by conviction for sin. The conscience is preach. The conscience is paid. Sorrow for sin leads to confession and willingness to straighten up the past life. Restitution is not a precept or doctrine limited to the period of the law. Before the law, I've shown you Genesis, there was restitution. It was written on man's conscience after the law. That is, when you come to the New Testament, you'll find that there is restitution. And it was in Genesis, before the law. It's in the Gospels. It's in the Acts of the Apostles. It's in the Epistles after the law, as well as in the constitution of nations in the world. Do you know the assertion in the constitution of nations of the world? They don't call it restitution. They call it reparation. Reparation. That is, you've taken something from the government, and now that you discover that you want to straighten out your life, they see there's reparation, and they want you to restore that. That's the meaning of all that is going on in our country now, that this person has stolen this million and is stolen this billion, and they are not saying, well, it's the time of ignorance and, you know, it doesn't matter at all, let him go with that. No, they call them, they bring them to books, and they say there must be, they call it redress. That is, you've done something wrong, you're going to make redress, or they call it repayment. The Bible calls it restitution, they call it reparation, they call it redress, they call it repayment, they call it compensation. You know, you've stolen something from that person. You've not been paying your house rent, and the landlord now takes you to court. The court will not say, well, you know, it's a Christian, and the grace of God has covered everything. No, they say, you must pay your house rent. You must do that. Calculate it from that time until this time. They may call it compensation, or sometimes they call it damages. They say, you've damaged the business of that person. You've damaged the personality of that person. Now you must, you know, pay damages. Restitution is demanded by God. It matters where money is involved. Such as fraud, such as theft, such as dishonest gain, such as unpaid bills, such as lies and false reports that injure or other people, such as misrepresentation, causing damage to others, and violations of the laws of the land. Everything must be straightened out when we say we're children of God. I'm coming to 2 Samuel chapter 12. 2 Samuel chapter 12. And here we're reading from verse 1. 2 Samuel chapter 12. We're reading from verse 1. Please open your Bible. Very important. Restitution is the proof of genuine repentance. In 2 Samuel chapter 12, verse 1, and the Lord sent Nathan unto David, and he came unto him and said unto him, there were two men in one city, and each one, and one rich and the other poor. The rich man had exceeding many flocks and herds, and but the poor man had nothing save one little ewe lamb, which he had brought, and nourished up, and it grew together with him and with his children. It did eat of his own meat and drank of his own cup, and lay in his bosom, and was unto him as a daughter. Verse 4, in verse 4 it says, and there came a traveler unto the rich man, and he spared to take of his own flock and of his own herd to dress for the wayfaring man that was come unto him, but took the poor man's lamb and dressed it for the man that was come to him. And David's anger was greatly kindled against the man. And he said unto Nathan, as the Lord liveth, the man that has done this shall surely die. And he shall restore, tell me, say it aloud. That was the word. The king, David, he didn't know about, he didn't know the end of the story. He just knew that this is a story. A story of something that took place in his kingdom. He didn't even ask, who is the person? He didn't even ask, how could somebody do that? He just said, he shall restore the land fourfold. Because he did this sin, and because he had no pity. That's restitution. Before Nathan said, thou art the man. Look at that. He will restore. How many fools? Tell me out aloud. Have you seen the family of David? Number one, the child that was born by Bathsheba died. One. Number two, Amnon, that defiled Tamar, his son to David, died. Number three, Absalom, his son to David, died. Number four, Adonijah, the son to David, died. Four of them. He killed Urias. That's the meaning of the parable. He didn't know that this was the meaning. He just saw that somebody took a lamb from somebody and then killed. He said, that person, according to the law, according to the word, will pay fourfold. And he paid fourfold. And you could see the trouble in his life, in his kingdom, even from then on. The word of God is telling us that restitution was before the law, and it was also after the law. We're coming to Ezekiel chapter 33. Ezekiel chapter 33, I'm reading from verse 14. Ezekiel 33, we're reading from verse 14. It says in verse 14, and again, when I say to the wicked, thou shalt surely die, if he turn from his sin, that's repentance, and do that which is lawful and right. If the wicked restore the pledge, repentance in verse 14, restitution in verse 15, and give again that he had robbed, and walk in the statutes of life, without committing iniquity, without going on in iniquity, I'm forgiven, so I can sin more. There is grace, so I can sin more. There's no consequence, so I can sin more. God is not judging anymore, I can sin more. He has assured me by the word of the prophet, when I turned, now you are forgiven. And since I'm forgiven, I can continue the career of sin. No, without committing iniquity. He shall surely live, he shall not die. None of his sins which he has committed shall be mentioned unto him. He has done that which is lawful and right, he shall live. We're coming to the New Testament, Matthew chapter 5. Matthew chapter 5, I'm reading from verse 23. Matthew chapter 5, verse 23, after the law now, in the ministry of Jesus Christ. Matthew 5, 23, therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, and there rememberest that thy brother has aught against thee. It's a brother, and you are living in his house, and sees a brother, is a child of God, and you are not paying your house rent, and the brother has asked once, what's the matter? Are you not a brother? Don't you have grace? Why are you coming to me, house rent all the time? Leave me. There's no house rent now. If you want whatever you want to do, a brother cannot take another brother to court. And they act as if there's no conscience. They act as if being a brother to a brother, we can cheat them. We can steal from them. We can deny them of their rights. And the brother, because he's helpless, he leaves him. But they come to the same church. And that brother will see him is either ministering this way or ministering that way. When you bring your gift to the altar, when you bring your service to the altar, and you remember that your brother has aught against you, it says, leave there thy gift before the altar, and go thy way, first be reconciled unto thy brother, and then come offer thy gift. Those are the words of Jesus. That's restitution. We're coming to Acts of the Apostles, chapter 24. Acts chapter 24, we're reading from verse 16. And herein do I exercise myself to have always a conscience void of offense toward God and toward men. You settle with God, you reconcile with God. But as a child of God, you want to have a conscience void of offense toward men, your fellow men. 1 Timothy chapter 5. 1 Timothy chapter 5, we're reading from verse 24. 1 Timothy chapter 5, verse 24. Some men's sins are opened beforehand, going before to judgment. What that means is, you've done something wrong. You say you've settled with God. Praise God, we can settle with God. But then you make it open. You go to the person that you offended. Maybe he didn't know about it. Maybe she didn't know about it. You slandered him. You misrepresented him. You defrauded him. You stole from him. Or you stole from his company. Or you stole from his family. Or you took something. Maybe even their daughter. You took their daughter. Whatever they'll do, they'll do. I love her. If they don't agree, I'm going to marry her by force. They are the people that will not take dowry. You take dowry, you don't take dowry, doesn't matter. I'm going to take the lady. And then we're on the way, you'll not find where we are. And then you come under conviction and you say, this is not right. I must make right my way. That, you know, he is a brother, he is a sister. Doesn't mean that I can just sin with impunity and just do whatever I want to do. Some men's sins are open beforehand. You come and you open it up. That's restitution. I'm sorry for this. I've done wrong. I shouldn't have done this. If it's money, I restore. If it's somebody's daughter you have taken without their permission, without their consent, you restore. If it is their business, you were doing business together, and then you did something and everything is now coming to your side, and the fellow has no gain, no profit, you make restitution. And then it says, it goes before you to judgment, because you've settled with God, you've settled with man. Look at the latter part of verse 24. Some men, they follow after. Some men, their sins follow them like a shadow. They keep on coming to church. They keep on, they say they are workers. They keep on, they do whatever they want to do. And their sin, they'll not make restitution. They say, my conscience does not condemn me. Just like the conscience of Pharaoh did not condemn him when he said, where is that God? Just like the conscience of Absalom did not convict him when he wanted to topple his father. Just like the conscience of Nebuchadnezzar did not torment him when he cast Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego into prison. Just like Herod did not have any conscience that condemned him when he killed all those children. Because the conscience is hardened. My conscience does not condemn me. I do whatever I want to do. I'm at liberty. I am free. Those who do restitution, their sins are open beforehand, going before them to judgment. And when they go to judgment, they will not be judged anymore. But these people that, you know, they just keep on sinning, keep on sinning, keep on sinning, open, secret, whatever, their sins follow after them. I'm praying the Lord will give us a conscience that will make restitution at the appropriate time before it's too late, in Jesus' name. Did somebody say amen? Amen? Acts of the Apostles, chapter 23. Acts of the Apostles, chapter 23. I'm reading here from verse 1. Acts, chapter 23. And we're reading from verse 1. Here it says in verse 1, and Paul, earnestly beholding the council, said, men and brethren, I have lived in all good conscience before God until this day. And the high priest Ananias commanded them to that stood by to smite him on the mouth. Then Paul said unto him, God shall smite thee, that whited wall. For thou sittest to judge me after the law, and commandest me to be smitten contrary to the law. Verse 4. And they that stood by said, revilest thou God's high priest? Paul, revilest thou God's high priest? Says, don't talk to me. I'm an apostle. He's high priest. I'm greater. I'm an apostle. I'm called. I'm sent. I'm commissioned. And I'm anointed. He is not born again. I am an apostle. I know the word of God. I know the law. He doesn't know the law. He's sitting to judge me. And then he says they should smite me contrary to the law. I said what I said because of who I am. No, Paul did not say that. The apostle did not say that. That minister did not say that. He had conscience. He had conscience. There are people that don't have any conscience. And they say they are ministers. And they say they are Christian workers. And they say they are church members. And they say they have repented. Look at Paul now in verse 5. Then said Paul, I wish not, brethren. I knew not, brethren. I'm wrong. I'm sorry. I knew not that he was the high priest. For it is written, thou shalt not speak evil of the ruler of thy people. That's restitution. But you know, the people that God, they step here, they step there, they do whatever. They don't have any conscience. There's no salvation there. There's no redemption there. And there's no remission of sin there. If we're children of God, our conscience will be tender. Our conscience will be clear. If we mistakenly say something wrong, if we mistakenly do something wrong, and we want to get to heaven, we don't just want to be apostle or prophet or preacher or evangelist or whatever, or, you know, Sunday scripture teacher. If we want to get to heaven, we'll make restitution promptly and appropriately. I come to point number 3, the personal pursuit of righteousness. As we are evangelizing, And as we are, you know, talking to people to repent and to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ and to come to the Lord, our joy is the joy of heaven, that they repent and that they turn from sin. If they turn from sin and they repent, the evidence of that repentance, there's a change of heart, there's a cleansing of heart, and there is the cleansing of their conscience, and they will do the right thing. And now they pursue after that restitution, they pursue righteousness, the personal pursuit of righteousness. We're looking at Matthew chapter 5, and I'm reading from verse 6. Matthew chapter 5, verse 6. Blessed are they which do hunger and thirst after righteousness, for they shall be filled. If we're truly born again, if we're truly children of God, we love righteousness. We're passionate about righteousness. We're pursuing righteousness. We're hungry, we're thirsty, we're praying, we're believing for righteousness. It tells us in Romans chapter 1. Romans chapter 1, I'm reading from verse 17. Romans chapter 1, we're reading from verse 17. It says in verse 17, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith. As it is written, the just shall live by faith. If we have faith in the Lord and we say we have repented and we say we have reconciled with God, there will be the pursuit of righteousness. Verse 18, for the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness, against all unrighteousness of men which hold the truth in unrighteousness. The people, they hold the truth in unrighteousness. Hear them teach, hear them preach, hear them counsel, hear them pray for people, hear them in public ministry. They hold the truth, but follow them home, between them and their wives, follow them to the office, in their places of work, follow them in their community, and you'll find they have unrighteousness. They just live anyhow and they do anything. You cannot dictate a difference between them and the unbeliever. Their profession, whatever their profession is having this profession, and their sinner is having this profession. It's only in the church is a Christian, only in the church is a repented fellow, only in the church is a righteous fellow. In the place of work, there's no difference between him and the unbeliever and the sinner. Think about your own profession. Think about what other people do in your profession, that we know this is not right. And you're in that profession, if your life is the same as that of the unbeliever, that means there's no evidence that you're a real child of God. Romans chapter 6, I'm reading from verse 11. Romans chapter 6, verse 11, the personal pursuit of righteousness. Likewise, reckon ye also yourselves to be dead indeed unto sin, but alive unto God through Jesus Christ our Lord. Let not sin therefore reign in your mortal body, that ye should obey each and the laws thereof. Neither yield your members as instruments of unrighteousness unto sin, but yield yourselves unto God as those that are alive from the dead, and your members as instruments of what? Of righteousness unto God. Look at verse 18. Being then made free from sin, ye became the servants of righteousness. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. 1 Corinthians chapter 15. We're reading from verse 33. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 33. Be not deceived, evil communications corrupt good manners. Awake to righteousness and sin not. That's the word of the Lord to the real believer, to the true believer. Awake to righteousness and sin not, for some have not the knowledge of God. I speak this to your shame. We're looking at Ephesians chapter 4. Ephesians chapter 4. And I'm reading from verse 20. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 20. It says in verse 20, but ye have not so learned Christ, if so be that ye have heard him, and have been taught by him as the truth is in Jesus, that he put off concerning the former conversation, the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful laws, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, and that ye put on the new man, which after God is created in righteousness and true holiness. That's the life of a real child of God. Wherefore, putting away, everybody tell me, putting away, let the Lord hear you, putting away. You know, there are people who say we're Christians, we're born again, and they tell lies. Wife to the husband, oh, he's my husband. If I tell him the truth, he'll be offended. And then they'll make their face normal and throw out the lie. If it's a real believer, who is the husband? The husband may not talk. The husband may not question. Don't think he bought the lie. He swallowed the lie. No. Even if he didn't know and he swallowed the lie, you're still a liar. It says you put away lying. You're working in an office and your boss happens to be a Christian or maybe a member of the church. And then you deal in lying. You cover up other people. He's your friend. And he came to you and said, I'm the one that told that. I'm the one that did that. All right. I'm a church member. I go to the same church with our boss. Whatever I tell him, he'll not turn the stone. He'll not examine it. Just don't say anything. I'll tell him what I need to tell him. And then he goes to tell the boss a lie. And the boss, thinking that that's a Christian, that's born again, is a member of our church, and is telling lies, they have no conscience. They've lost salvation. They've lost their relationship with God. If we're Christians, we pursue righteousness. Wherefore, putting away lying, speak every man truth with his neighbor. For we are members one of another. Verse 28. Let him that stole steal no more, but rather let him labor, walking with his hands the things which is good. The thing which is good, that he may have to give to him that needeth. Verse 29. Let no corrupt communication proceed out of your mouth, but that which is good to the use of edifying, that it may minister grace to the hearers. Grieve not the Holy Spirit of God, whereby ye are sealed unto the day of redemption. Let all bitterness, the people who carry bitterness about, were born again, let all bitterness and wrath and anger and clamor and evil speaking be put away from you with all malice, and be kind one to another, tender hearted, your conscience is tender, forgiving one another, even as God for Christ's sake has forgiven you. We don't know when the rapture will take place. It could take place anytime from now. Righteousness should be the personal, earnest, constant pursuit of every believer in Christ. If he wants to have that glorious rest in heaven as his goal, knowing the time is short, knowing that the rapture is imminent, knowing that the coming of Christ is near at the very door, he makes no excuse for sin. He makes no provision for compromise. A true believer gives no attention to temptation. The consuming passion, the consuming work of that true minister is to lead sinners to repentance and to righteousness, not to fill the church with unrepentant, hell-bound sinners. And so as we are evangelizing and we're reaching out to the people of the world, we're not just saying, come as you are. No matter who you are, no matter what you are doing, it matters what they do. It matters whether they repent or not. And then they come to the church, and then somebody will, you take them, raise up your hand, they raise up their hands, and then after that they put down their names. That very Sunday, they take them to the riverside, and they baptize them, and they say, you are now our members. Are you working for God or working for yourself? Do you know what he requires? There must be repentance. There must be restitution. There must be the pursuit of righteousness. Let us moderate our zeal with the word of God. Don't go against the word of God because you are zealous. You are zealous. I want this now. I want this now. This place will triple in 1 year. It's not like that. If it triples with saints, with repentant people, with children of God, all right. If not, it's labor that is wasted. We're coming to Revelation chapter 19. Revelation chapter 19, verse 7. Let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him. For the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife has made herself ready. And to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. For the fine linen is, everybody tell me, the righteousness of the saints. Our zeal for the kingdom, our commitment to the great commission, emphasize repentance, emphasize restitution, emphasize righteousness of life, righteousness of heart, consistent righteousness, and living for the glory of God. Let's rise up and talk to the Lord in prayer. Examine your ministry. Examine your emphasis. Examine your preaching. Examine your ministration. Examine the leanings that you have. Open yourself to the Spirit of God. Have you repented yourself? Is there an evidence of that repentance? Do you love the word of God, the word of repentance? Are you submissive and yielded to the voice of the Spirit saying, this is the way, go ye therein? Or is your emphasis now on worshiping Bagada church building? Is your emphasis on come and see building? Let's bring people out of sin unto the Savior. Let's bring people to real, definite conviction and living by the word of God, earnestly contending for the faith once delivered unto the saints.